Hi, everybody. This is Albert, your host for this virtual meeting with Lalita and Amol Jain, who would be talking with us about their session at Regional Scrum Gathering Hyderabad on the topic, the secret sauce of Team Symphony. Let me introduce Lalita. Lalita is a CSM, CSPO, and CSP working as an enterprise agile coach at TCS. She has a sharp focus towards lean software development, design thinking, and highly passionate towards seeking innovative solutions to challenging situations and process improvements, and love to work with global distributed teams. She is an enthusiastic agile practitioner, well-recognized speaker in many agile conferences like Agile India. Amol Jain is joining Lalita. Joining Lalita, who is also an enterprise agile coach at TCS. With 15 years of IT experience, he is passionate in helping organizations transform to realize their true potential. He is well known within industry for transforming organization using scaling frameworks like SAFe, LESS, and other frameworks. So, as Lukács says, H.E. Lukács says, no one can whistle a symphony. It takes an orchestra to play it. So let's talk to Lalita and Amol about how did they build symphony with teams and what is that secret sauce that binds and bring true potential of the team. Hi, Amol. Hi, Lalita.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi. So Lalita, and before we go into the talk, can you tell about yourself a little bit?
You want me to talk about myself?
Yes.
Hi, so my name is Lalita. I am an agilist. I am a passionate people evangelist. I love challenging the status quo. I love seeking innovative solutions.
Okay.
And I love meeting different peoples. And I love working with global distributed setups. In my experience so far working towards agility, I have built immense knowledge and a lot of experience just looking at things from a different perspective. I think that is what keeps me really passionate about all the agility.
Okay. Okay. Amol, how about you? Can you tell about yourself?
Okay. Hi, my name is Amol Jain, and I would say one of my key things are I like people development. So as an agile coach, as I work with different organizations, help them transform, moving from waterfall to agile, what I really like is looking at what the impediments in the organization are, what are some of the leaders doing, where is the frozen middle layer, and how can we actually change and move people from point A to point B. So that is my real passion, because everything is around people. Whether you talk about tools, technology, all the things come in place. But my main focus is how can we actually change and develop people. Agile transformation automatically happens. People is the main. And that is the topic of our presentation also. We are focusing on the individuals today.
Oh, so the complete talk is about people and the individuals of the team members?
We're going to have a heavy focus on actually the first value, individuals and interaction.
Okay.
We want to talk more at a individual aspect and how the whole interactions model works towards it.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to talk also about a human iceberg model, where basically when we meet individuals, what does that mean, right? And how important it is to build motivated individuals to have motivated teams.
So when we speak about individuals, there are a lot of personality types involved, correct? So each personality talks and interacts differently with different other personality types. How do you bridge this, or are you covering on this area aspects?
We do have a concept of a Johari window, where every two people have a Johari window for each other, because suppose I'm talking to you, I can only see your behavior, and I only know a little bit about you, but there is a lot of blind spot, there are a lot of hidden things, and there's a lot of unknown about you and for you about me.
Yes.
Now, as we interact more, we basically remove that blind spot with a feedback loop, and the hidden part is removed through the self-disclosures. And with that, we basically open up the entire ecosystem of two individuals so that the interactions can improve, the feedback can improve, the self-disclosures can improve, and that will lead to whatever the personality types are, the team cohesion will gradually improve. Because I'm just talking about two people, but within the team, each person will have a Johari window with the other person.
Yes, we have so eight people. Yeah. We have eight people on that.
So we are talking about all the permutations and combinations.
Okay.
So that gradually helps us to elevate, know our team members, and how can we take it to the next level so that the teams actually know about each other and they are more open. Because if I'm just talking to somebody new in the team, that person may not be that receptive, or I may have a lot of biases and beliefs and I may judge that person. But if I know more about him, I know more about the blind spot, and if I disclose more about my personal situation and I know about the other person's personal situation, so within the team, I can understand the other person more, and I think the team cohesion really improves as those things improve. So Johari window is one of the key aspects, I would say, in improving the team performance as well as the team integration.
So you just mentioned
focus on understanding people's without having your own biases and judgments. It's highly important, because many times we as individuals look at others from our own lens of judgments.
Yes.
It takes a lot of time to take out that judgmental view and look at things with a neutral stance. And that's what we're going to emphasize in our talk.
Okay. So your talk is going to give us some tools that we can use as a users or as a delegate in with our teams?
Yes. So we're going to talk about the MBTI tool, which is a very powerful and useful technique. Actually, there are different types of personalities. The challenging situation is that we many times make assumptions about others, and we try to use the same vanilla method for everybody. And that's what we're going to also emphasize on different types of personalities, the specific characteristics, and which can be used, actually. It's very powerful to apply that and see what kind of personalities you have in the team so that you have a really gelling, cohesive force in that.
Okay. So when you just discussed, you said like team will open up or the individuals will open up. So how do you bring that? Because to open up, if I want to open up with you, I need to trust you, correct? So how do you build that trust factor within the team? And it is not just about one person with you, and but this is about eight people and then multiple teams. How do you build this trust factor? And do we have anything?
There are two aspects here. One is from the leadership point of view, because I am also an agile pyramid lead in my organization. So if you look at from the leader point of view, you need to create a safety net or a psychological safety for the team members. Like, it could be okay for them to fail fast and fail cheap. It's okay for them to learn. There should be no penalties for that. At the same time, they should be open up. They should be free to open, like speak, open up and talk any kind of topics they want to talk about, do some sort of innovation. I typically give one day of innovation time for many of my team members. They can go and do whatever they want, and that really brings in very good results.
Okay.
So this really helps the team to collaborate and focus.
Looks like the network is a little bit slow. We will get back. Just give it a minute. Network is... Yeah, we can go. We can go ahead. Yes.
Yeah, what was your question, Albert?
The question is on the how do we manage the psychological safety of the team? Because to trust you, I first need to trust you to open up. So how do you bring that psychological safety? That's what we were talking about.
Yeah. So as Amol was also answering that question, Albert, it's like you don't establish trust in a day. It requires some conscious effort to first of all establish a strong trust ground in the team. Like Amol was trying to say that having that sense of safety, psychological safety is very important. So I need to, first of all, really work with my teams to take out that psychological fear. I mean, I have to make the team comfortable that they can express themselves as truly, as comfortably. I'm not here just to look for the good things that are happening, but I'm also here to help them for the things that are not really working well for them.
Okay.
If I really do not focus on taking out the whole aspect of fear, it ends up into aspects of psychological safety not being there, people working in silos because there is not enough trust established within people, and they don't share things with each other, and then we really don't see a healthy team dynamics.
Mm. And as leaders, we also need to give some space for innovation, empower the teams so that they are able to do any kind of work they want to do. At the same time, they should not feel that this is my goal, and if I fail, there would be some penalties, my bonuses may get impacted. So there are a lot of those behaviors in the organizations today, because of which people are not able to open up, they are not able to trust the individuals in other teams. So as leaders, giving the safety net to the team, and as teams, creating an environment where they can come together and work together to focus more on the effectiveness rather than just focusing on the efficiency.
Okay. So in a whole, you are saying the leader should not throw away the process and agile out of window when that deadline is nearing. Rather, we need to work with the team to ensure the deadline is good.
I would say it's more of a collaborative thing. So, because whatever the product is, that is also important. We have to give it. But at the end, like there is a concept of release planning also in the agile world.
Yes.
So, if you build 10 features, I can say it's okay to do 8 features, but do them properly. The design should be good. The code should be a clean code rather than we just get away with testing. Or there could be some new innovation the team can bring in those 8 features, which can give us a better ROI.
So, okay.
And also the team also feels really some sort of self-accomplishment that, okay, this is something we have done and we are coming together as a team. So that team kind of a feeling would start coming in.
Okay.
But if it is more transaction-based, then the team should say, okay, you gave me this, I gave you that. So the team cohesion and a team spirit is really not in place.
Yeah, I mean, I think we have to understand that to have sustainability in the system, we really want to establish long-running, happy teams.
Okay.
Some teams are happy to stay together longer.
Okay.
And they are really looking for giving productive results.
Okay. So to have a happy employees or the team members, do we have any metric or do we have any measure that we can measure going forward to see whether I am having a happy team or not? How do we measure? Because at the end, as a leader or as an organization, they look for measurements. Correct?
It is something that you really feel and experience in the environment.
Okay.
Yes, I can have happiness index surveys sent over with the teams, but the level of energy that you experience when your environment, when your teams are happy, is different. It cannot be completely just measured in the form of some KPIs or quantifiable measures. So I give focus also equally to that level of environment, that happy environment which is created in the whole culture.
Okay.
And as well as that, like one of the other things we typically do, not really a metrics, on the physical board for the team, they can have a team mood. So every day based on after the stand up, they can say, this is our team mood today. And if it is not good, they can discuss what is really not working for us. How can we make the team mood more happy? So that way the leaders can also jump in and support as servant leaders, and the team themselves would know, okay, somebody in the team is out sick, or somebody met with an accident, or there could be n number of reasons why the team mood is not good. So all those kind of things, not really metrics by numbers, but those are more, I would say, qualitative things which can help improve the team spirit.
Okay. So that means you are talking about the daily stand-up board, right? The daily scrum board. In the scrum board, are we talking?
I'm talking about a physical radiator, basically. Information radiator. So it could be next to the physical scrum board, or some sort of a digital way, or whatever the way the team wants, because it's more of a self-organizing team. Whatever way they want to track it. So that is one way I'm telling you that is something that is possible to just have an information radiator and just capture the team mood when they meet every day in the morning for the stand-up. And anyways, they'll be operating for the entire day.
Okay,
so we're going to also link it with the whole aspect of Maslow's hierarchy of needs. We're going to also associate, basically, when we talk about individuals, what are the different levels of needs that need to be established, that need to be met. We're going to also associate that with team dysfunctions and explain on what kind of dysfunctions are in place when those needs are not met. Okay. Let's understand the core theme of our talk is going to be on human, on individuals. And that's why these basic needs are important to be met, first of all, to see that healthy happiness in the team.
Okay. So based on our talk, it looks like very exciting time ahead during your session, right? And really,
we are hoping for the same, and we are very excited to be part of the Regional Scrum Gathering Conference.
Yeah. We are very happy, and we are waiting for your talk. Yeah.
And look forward to it.
Yeah, we too looking forward to it. And thank you. Thank you, Amol, and thank you, Lalita, for sharing some insight about your talk and what we can expect from your talk. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye. Thanks, Albert. Yeah.
Thanks, guys. Bye.
Bye. Bye for now. Bye.